Everybody, I would like to thank the organizers for giving me the opportunity to present some of our ideas in this workshop. Let me introduce myself. I'm Maria Damanaki, and I'm the Global Director for Oceans for the Nature Conservancy. Since the Nature Conservancy is not working in Europe, at least for the moment, I would like to say a few words about this organization. So the Nature Conservancy is one of the biggest, maybe the biggest, environmental organization around the world. We have projects in 70 countries. We have a staff almost 4,000 around the world, and we have 600 top scientists, because our idea is that all our interventions have to be focused on science. We are saying that we are science-driven. So we don't protect an area, we don't intervene to a conservation problem, an environmental problem, unless we have concrete science that can give us a full idea about our impact. And this is, I think, creates a niche for us, referring to other NGOs. We are very, very also devoted to try to find a balance between the environment and the people. So usually we say that we would like to keep both nature and people happy, and we think it is possible. Our scientists have given a lot of proof for that. The last point that I can say about the Nature Conservancy is that we try to use a lot corporate engagement and financial tools to leverage the money we are receiving from donors. We have a big portfolio, we are not complaining, but the money is not enough, never enough, so we are trying to leverage up to create corporate engagement partnerships, to create new financial tools, and I hope I can have some time to give you a couple of examples on that. So this is Nature Conservancy. We have a four managing director, global managing director for lands, cities, water, and ocean. I'm running the ocean program. I'm going to focus today on climate change and the responses, our responses to climate change. Let me share with you some thoughts about what's happening around the world now. So all the efforts about tackling this big issue are mainly focused on energy. I can say energy comes first. If you are asking a person what we are going to do about climate change, he or she is going to answer, we have to clean up energy. And this is very good and very, very, how can I say, it has brought very good results. So since 2000, we have really overcome all our expectations about alternative forms of energy, about renewables. There is a huge expansion of this sector. Also, we have a lot of saving energy programs that are also very, very fruitful. But my question to you and to everybody is, can we really be happy? Can we handle climate change through these solutions? And the answer is no. I would like to be very, very specific about that. Our scientists say that even if we do our best about renewables and about energy savings, we are not going to be able to reach the Paris Agreement targets. And you know that Paris Agreement targets are not very, very ambitious. They are reasonable, but they are not the best. And they were even criticized that they were not enough. So even those targets cannot be reached if we go with business as usual. So we have to do more. We have to do more. And what is more? The answer is rather clear. We have to do something about the emissions that are already there. So it will take us a couple of decades to clean up all energy we are using, to decarbonize energy. And now we are in front of a big change, a revolution, I can say. I think that for the next decade, the zero car will be used broadly. This will be really a revolution. But it needs a lot of electricity. Zero carbon cars need a lot of electricity, and this huge potential of electricity is going to disturb a lot the grids that are already there and perhaps will be incapable of doing all that. So even if we do our best, we cannot solve the problem. We have to do something about the emissions that are already there, the greenhouse emissions that are already there. So reducing the emissions that we are going to produce from now on is not enough. We have to do something about the emissions that are already there. And what will be that? We have to capture these emissions, we have to capture the CO2, which is already there in the atmosphere, and store it. We cannot reach Paris Agreement targets without doing that. How we can do that? There are a lot of ideas around the world. Geoengineering is doing very well. We are working on that as an organization. There are a lot of very good results. Also, we have bioenergy and other programs. These programs, though, are technologically challenging and very, very expensive. Really very, very, very expensive. So we have worked with our scientists, and we have a solution for this complicated situation. And the solution is, to make a long story short, that we have to use science itself and nature itself in order to solve the problem. So we have to create a bridge between the natural capital and climate change. Just to give you an example about that. Let's see a tree. We have a tree. A tree is a very beautiful view, especially under these temperatures, the temperatures now. But it's more than that. The tree is the most advanced technologically device about carbon sequestration that exists on the planet now. And it is given to us from nature. So if, for example, we can use the tree as it is, absorbs CO2, puts CO2 in the soils, store it in a very natural way, this can give us a big part of the solution. And here comes our study. We have funded for 3 years now a very, very big study. I cannot reveal all the numbers because they are under embargo. We hope we can publish the study in 2 months. But what I can reveal, and this is very, very important, is that our study proves that we can, if we are going to use fully the natural capital, then we can bring on board 1/3 of the solution of climate change challenge. The natural climate solutions based on exploiting the nature, what is already there, can give us 30% of the solution of climate change. So this is really amazing, and if we are going to be able to do that, this can give us a lot of additional value. So forests can absorb a lot of CO2 emissions, but we are not talking only about forests. Farmlands can do the same. Wetlands, coastal wetlands can do the same. Coral reefs, mangrove reefs can do the same. And we have to find all these ideas, especially in countries where the forests are not, how can I say, are very well restored. I'm not referring to Greece, but okay, Greece can be an example. So what these countries can do? They can invest in their oceans. And I would like very much to focus on oceans. I'm running this program, so I have some expertise there. But I would like to refer to the blue ecosystems. The blue ecosystems are seagrass, salt marshes, and mangrove forests. If we can restore these ecosystems, we can have a great contribution to the climate change solution. And just to give you an example, I can refer to Mediterranean, who is around. Mediterranean is has the biggest seagrass in the world, and all this area can absorb the plants that are there, type of, can absorb three times more CO2 than a tree, than the land grass. If you have a forest of mangroves, it can absorb four times more than a forest on land. So we have to focus on that, and we have to create the good idea, the best solutions and the technology and everything that we have to do to persuade governments to focus on that. So for the moment, we have seen that we have 151 countries around the world who have at least one of these blue carbon ecosystems, and we have 71 countries that contain all three of these blue carbon ecosystems. This is our target. We are trying to work with all these countries in order to give the best solutions. This is our ambition. So I have four big projects now. We are working in Mexico, in Australia, in Indonesia, and in the United States, of course. And we are trying to implement a number of demonstration projects in order to quantify the benefits and model the ability of carbon sequestration. Because this will be a great contribution, we can persuade the governments if we can have numbers, if we can give them the numbers, how much they are going to receive from these projects. Our main partner is World Bank, of course, but we are working also with other NGOs and other organizations around the world to do that. So we have published recently a report in Marrakesh. We have a conference of the parties for the Paris Agreement in Marrakesh. I would like to give you the link for that report, because it is a report by IUCN and TNC and everybody in the world now they can agree that this is what is the best and most advanced about all these solutions. You can see if you want what is happening there. But in order to work about especially mangroves and mangrove protection, we thought that our ability was not enough. So we have taken the initiative, and now we have created the Global Mangrove Alliance. So the three biggest NGOs on environment are there: WWF, the Nature Conservancy, and Conservation International. We are working together to save mangroves around the world. Our target is to increase 20% the mangroves until 2030. I think it's very difficult but realistic target, and we are going to work on that. So this is an example how we can move forward. But to come back to the investment in nature, I can say to you that we have found out that only 2% of the investment that is going to climate change, adaptation and mitigation is connected with natural climate solutions. So though nature is there, though nature is the most advanced technologically asset we can have, we are not investing on that. Why? We are not investing on that. We have been working on that. We had studies. To make a long story short, we have put forward this idea. And the idea is that the nature has a value that can be seen and has a value that cannot be seen. So if we can capture the value and we can measure, we can calculate, and give the governments, the authorities, a real number about the value of nature, this can persuade them to go for the natural climate solutions. We have started from that, but now we have a big program about how we can value the nature. I'm very happy because I have seen that Phoebe has presented something connected to that. So what we are trying to do is to capture the value and give it a number, give it a name. It's very difficult, very complicated. My dream, just to explain to you, is to give a number to the value of ocean and persuade the governments, the corporates, and everybody, if they use the ocean, to pay for this for the price. But I suppose this is far away from the reality. But what we are trying to do is to capture the unseen. What is the unseen? Let's suppose that we are looking to a forest. Let's suppose that we are looking to the ocean. If we are looking to a forest, we see a beautiful view. We are thinking, yes, there is a great value here, tourism perhaps, yes, but that forest is there not only for that. This forest can protect us from natural disasters, from flooding. This forest can clean the water. This forest can give us food. This forest can have a great contribution to biodiversity. Similar, referring to the oceans, if we have a coral reef, this coral reef is beautiful. You can snorkel around it. But at the same time, this coral reef can protect you from a tsunami. It can clean the water. It is a spawning area for fish. It can give you food. It can improve biodiversity, all like that. So here is our product. We call it Mapping Ocean Wealth Atlas. And this is a great project that tries to capture the ecosystem's value around the world for all ecosystems. We are not advanced equally about all ecosystems. What we have finalized for a moment is this map. You can see the atlas. You can see in the left side or the right side of this slide there. So we have created together with the World Tourism Council this innovation product, which is an atlas of the coral reef wealth around the world. And actually, we are very proud. We have taken last May in Bangkok the first prize, global prize, innovation prize about this product. So what is the idea? Let's imagine of a shark. You have a shark. Let's go to Palau, where this shark is, I mean, somewhere in the Pacific. If you fish, take this shark from the sea, and you sell it, you are going to have, let's say, we have calculated that it's $108 current price. If you leave it there, and you can take the advantage of all the value this shark can bring to nature, for tourism, for biodiversity, et cetera, its price is $1.4 million. So this is what we are trying to do. We are trying to put a number in the coral reefs around the world. And we have found out that we have hundreds of corals, hundreds of coral reefs that we call million-dollar reefs around the world. Because their value is $1 million, referring to tourism, referring to biodiversity, referring to other issues. We have found that around the world, the value of corals is $36 billion. 19 of these billions are coming from the tourism industry, and the rest is coming from other activities around these coral reefs. And we are working with a lot of governments now who have these million-dollar reefs in their area and try to persuade them that they have to take advantage of them. So we are working, for example, with Florida, with Bahamas, with Mexico, in Indonesia, in Australia, in Mauritius, in a lot of areas, Seychelles, to persuade governments that they have to protect these reefs for climate change, but also for their own interest. And some of them are responding well, I can say, better than we thought. So this is the idea. We can create the management, the tools for solutions that can take the advantage of nature about climate change. So we count what is there. We are trying to put a figure. We are trying to model the additional value. Then we are going to the governments and try to persuade them to include all this idea in their national contributions to the Paris Agreement. We had some success. We had already worked and persuaded almost 10 countries to do that, and we hope we can do more, maybe 5 countries more in the next decade. But we have to speed up, because if we are not doing that very, very soon, we are going to lose the opportunity. All this needs money. I don't want to forget about money. So we need donations to do our work, but we are trying to leverage up the money, as I explained. So I'm going to present just two financial tools we are using a lot, but two financial tools we are using, which are more indicative about our work. So we have done the Seychelles debt swap. What is that? I'm going to simplify a little bit, but I signed there, and we have bought a debt of Seychelles, of the government of Seychelles, to the Paris Club. So it was something around 110, if I remember well, of debt that the government of Seychelles, they owed to the Paris Club countries. We have put there $5 million from our donors, and we have created an impact capital tool, an investment tool, around 15 million more. And then we went there, we negotiated with the Paris Club, we have taken a debt forgiveness. To make a long story short, we are taking the responsibility for this debt now, the Nature Conservancy and our partners, and in exchange, the government of Seychelles, they have signed with us. I have a team already there. We're doing all the maritime special planning for the big exclusive economic zone of Seychelles. Seychelles, perhaps you know, it's a tiny island, but the exclusive economic zone, it's something around Europe, European Union. It's the same case. And we are doing all that in the most sustainable way, so fisheries, protected species, everything is there. And we have created the biggest marine protected area in the Indian Ocean, 400,000 kilometers around Seychelles, which is monitored and managed by the government and us. We have created an independent fund to do all that, and we are still working there. We're going to work there for a decade to bring everything back to sustainability. So this was a debt swap. We are exchanging debt for conservation solutions. We are putting some money, but the outcome is much more than what we are putting in. And we also, through the impact investment, we can leverage up money from investors who would like to invest on that. So this is a combination of donation and investment. And now we are trying to scale it up. So I'm working now with five small island states in Caribbean to do the same, to buy their debts. And I'm doing perhaps a couple of them in the Pacific area too. So this is what I'm working. I hope that until 2020 I can work with that. Of course, we have great partners. We are working with World Bank. We are working with big investors. We are working with big private banks. But we have some good results. Here is another product, financial product we have about conservation. So. To make a long story short, just the bottom line is that we hope we can have an insurance product to announce during this year. And we're going to have the first issue of a blue bond, a blue resilient bond soon, maybe in the next 2 years. We are working on that. We have also here great partners. About the insurance, we are working together with Swiss Re and Lloyd's of London and Munich Re. Recently, we are engaged with them. What we are trying to do, let's make it simple. I'll try to make it simple. We are working in Mexico. We have a big program there with Swiss Re, but we are working also with local communities, and we are working also with the Hotel Owners Association. We are going to restore the whole area that the tourism of Mexico is, all the coastal infrastructure, mangroves, sea grasses, coral reefs. So if this is fully protected, then the insurance company can be sure that they can go for insure payments that are at a lower interest rate. Why? Because this natural infrastructure can protect this area from natural disasters. And we have proof for that. So just to give you an example, 100 meters of a mangrove forest can reduce the wave height down to 66%. A big coral reef in front of something, let's say a coastal area, can reduce the energy of a wave down to 95%. So the risk management costs less. We can reduce the risk management for insurance companies. This is what we offer by when we restore and manage the natural infrastructure. In exchange, they can sign contracts with hotel owners at a lower rate. There is a premium. We take this premium and we fund our next projects. This is the idea of the insurance product. It's not there yet, but I hope we can announce that in Malta conference of the European Commission and European External Action Service in October. But I hope that in the next 2 years we can do that. The resilient bond is slightly different. I don't want to come into details, but the idea is that we are going to pay in advance to be sure that the restoration is there, so a possible investor then come and invest with less risk. So also this is a management risk management tool we are using. So these ideas are good for having a better cash flow for us to work on. This, of course, natural climate solutions in the sea have to be connected with our whole strategy. And our whole strategy is called Blue Growth by Design. I'm very proud because I have introduced this term and this program, Blue Growth, in European Commission when I was serving there as a commissioner. So Blue Growth by Design is we are for blue growth. We don't close the ocean. We believe that human presence there can be sustainable. But in order to ensure sustainability, we design. So it means that we map, we work with scientists, we use marine planning, and then we use sustainable methods for everything. So for overfishing, for habitat loss, for protection at scale, this is something that can be really effective. So this this work, we are trying to reform fisheries all over the world. We have started from the biggest fisheries, the most lucrative fishery, which is tuna, the biggest fishery, which is anchoveta. We are trying to put all these stocks back to sustainability. It will take some time, but in the meantime, if we connect all the linkages, so natural solutions, good management, good governance, good policy decisions, then I think we can move faster. So this is in a nutshell. I can say that our program is well known worldwide. We are not working in Europe. This was a decision by our board because they believe that the money is needed more in Pacific, in Africa, in other areas. But we have taken a lot of prices. Financial price last year was us for the debt swap and other innovation tools. And we would like to work in the Mediterranean, so I have this plan and dream, and I hope we can work together and bring a big project here, perhaps to do something about Mediterranean blue seagrass and connection to climate change, or to do something about marine special planning. We can be in the heart of the conservation decisions. This is from me. Thank you very much for your attention. I know that you are very willing to...